Okay, thank you very much. My name is Sylvanus Ward. I work for Keeping Alive Societies Hope. My question is closely related to a question that was asked earlier, and this is on scalability. There's a lot of potential with the county governments currently. There's a project that we are doing that engages youth who are in secondary schools. And the county government of Mombasa particularly came to realize that now that we are not directly concerned with, for instance, primary and secondary school education, your model is a very good one to reach youth, particularly on issues of patriotism. So my aim is to ask, because the county governments are also directly involved with the vocational training institutes, there's a lot of potential if they're able to buy that and also to build on the skills. So that by the end of the day, this is institutionalized.
I'm going to ask Joyce to address that. She has a direct connectivity to right now 5 and soon to be 9 counties.
Yeah, so I agree with you. There's a lot of potential within the counties. Not only do they have resources, but also the vocational institutions and a lot of the infrastructure out there depends on them. So we are working very closely with them. The Youth Employment Compact, apart from Nairobi, are all being pioneered by the county government. So, and also even the national government, you can't forget national government. The Ministry of Youth has not yet been devolved. They have a big World Bank project, they have resources. So we are harnessing all resources that we can get. Yeah.
I think that Joyce mentioned the Youth Employment Compacts in the various counties that they're working that are county government, but also include private sector and other youth employment related stakeholders. This is something to watch. This is really grassroots policy development strategy that's being initiated through the KES program. Let's come back here to the show.
Thank you very much. My name is Alan Farah. I work for Mascos. Actually, I'm the chief appointed for the program. I have a few comments. First of all, I want to agree with Mark and Abdulkhari on the significance of having the right tools, skills, and also the right facilitators. Because for you to make a meaningful and productive, you must get the right things done the right way. And that's why results are very important for us. And therefore, I totally agree with you that if you don't have the right people, things may change, may not happen. Youth-driven activities is what I have to comment about. We have worked so many youths and we have realized the significance of changing the perception of youth first. Before you change, because unless they change their perception, for example, one of the questions you ask is, what is your contribution to society? Hey, I'm still going through education, I have nothing to contribute. That's the kind of response you get from them. But you can engage them in activities that they can make a meaningful contribution to society. Actually, become productive to society. We have done that in Somalia and we have seen the difference. So engaging with the youth in such a way that they take leadership of the programs, they take the initiative themselves, is very critical. But I want also to share with you one experience. What do you say? I don't know, there seems to be a correlation between the level of education and the level of expectation. More youths who are highly educated with degrees, university degrees, who are first form force are on the seas dying, and less youth who have more education are staying at home and supporting the families. What do you call that kind of fallacy? Whereas those who have got education because they can't secure a job. So the whole thing about, for my case now, the whole thing about is how do you relate education to employment? Must we change that perception and say that education is not necessarily for job seeking, but for also making that contribution to life? Because all of you go to school with the intention to become a white collar job or something like that. If it doesn't make sense, they go ISIS. And that's the reality now of Somalia. So many people through universities are also diseased and dying. So that's, I want to hear from the panel. What's your view about this kind of challenge? This is a real situation in Somalia. Just recently, 200 kids died. And most of them are said to be university graduates. They completed and they felt frustrated. So how do you solve this need that get education and then you must be employed?
I think it's good. I appreciate diversity and dynamics to contest in this. From Somalia's perspective, I think the reason as to why the educated youth are the ones who are going out and who are involved in illegal migration and dying of this when they're en route to Europe, mostly. It's as a result of the expectation of the society from these youths. I mean, if they can go to colleges, if they can go to universities. So what happens now, it's up to you to provide for the family. And then it's like they are compared to other youths in other regions and in other countries. Like, you're already graduates. I mean, why can't you provide these millions? Why can't you passport ABCD? Why can't you do this? And in some situations you have, because not all of them are getting employment, you have examples from them who are employed by the government or by other actors, including us, USAID, and even our partners. It's like, these are already employed and they're doing a lot. Some are involved in business. Why can't you do one? As a result, the pressure is too much on them, and so they have to look for alternative means of seeking livelihood, and that is why they mostly, they have the belief that Europe, outside Africa, is where the opportunities are. And in the event of seeking these opportunities, this is where they use their lives. But looking at the other side, those who do not go to school, I mean, the expectation is not much from the society. He brings on table a dollar a day or $100 a day. I mean, there's not too much pressure on them. So the solution to it, from my perspective and in my view, is bringing and changing the mindset of the youth. Experiential learning is where it comes. I mean, them being involved in, you know, like you teaching them business skills and entrepreneurship skills. Can you give them an example? Can you, like, of writing plans and business proposals and all this? Can you, like, enable their abilities and capacities by give them a share, for example? Not just USAID or actors, but even from the government perspective. Can you give them the skills of drawing business plans? You could even get resources from the community. Remember, every year the Somali community gives out, the rich Somalis give out Zaka, for example. Can they use the same resources or Sotara? Can they use the same resources to bring up business? And in time, the subsequent years, they will themselves share their resources again with their peers and Somali colleagues. That is my view to this.
Okay, we move on. We have. Did you want to get a response? No. Okay. Next question.
And I do concur with the last comment that has just been said in terms of looking at other aspects of the entrepreneurial aspect of the youth. I think we're all stuck with this aspect that every youth wants to get a job, and knowing the youth as we interact with them a lot. Majority of them right now don't actually want to get an H-5 job. And so, and one of the things I wanted to ask Sylvia, especially with regards to their curriculum, we understand the millennials now are totally different, you know, and they're totally different from Generation Z, X, and the previous people that would actually be loyal people who would work from H-5. I don't know whether your curriculum has integrated more so the change in terms of what the youth are expecting in terms of the new work environment. And also as you influence the employers who you're approaching to employ, do you actually engage them to say, to help them, sensitize them in terms of the change of culture, especially the youth who are coming on board?
All right. Statistically, for you to be able to excel in an entrepreneurship role, you need some sort of mentorship, some sort of support, and some sort of like guidance in your entry into the entrepreneurship world. The way we have curated the curriculum is we set the expectations right for this youth that when you're coming in, you're coming in for formal employment. You're going to be in a job 8 to 5, and these are your expectations. Are you aligned to this? Are you not aligned? And if you're aligned, let's go and move on to formal employment. When we have this youth, the bootcamp for 6 weeks, there is a portion of the curriculum that we call the mindset, which is really the holy grail of our curriculum. And what we do here is ingrain them that the job that we are training you for is just for the stepping stone. There is a lot more for you out there. Take up this opportunity to learn, and your growth will be limitless. That is the way we shape them to take up entrepreneurship, because we have seen a lot of entrepreneurship programs that come into country and train people, but really it does not propel the youth to be successful business people. So it's changing their mindsets to that entrepreneurship a state of mind. Later on, after you have gotten the kind of mentorship and growth naturally into that world.
Okay, we have time for one last question.
Okay, so my name is Felix Egefu, and I'm from the Akan Foundation. My question goes to either KS or Generation. I'm interested to know, how well do these youths integrate in the working environment after they have been placed? And by that I mean, have there been any formal follow-ups done 6 months, 1-2 years down the road to determine, are they performing up to standard? Are they relating well to others? Because my assumption is that if they dropped out in class 8, how effective are they? But I want to appreciate all the presenters. I think they were quite engaging.
That's a great question.
Yeah, so before they are placed, we take them through work readiness skills. So in every vocational training institution, we have instructors who have been taken through work readiness curriculum. So by the time they go and they are placed onto a job, we also follow them up, and every 6 months we carry out a survey. It's called an employer satisfaction survey, just, you know, to try and see how we can improve.
Let's give Sylvia a chance to close it out for us. Thanks.
Yes, I can take that question, because we have had a lot of postgraduate mentorship and follow-up. We talked about, I had talked earlier about the 7 pillars that we have in a generation methodology, and one of them is postgraduate mentorship or support to form a strong alma mater within the generation. So we do quarterly employer or supervisor surveys, as well as we go directly to the youth to ask them, how are you actually doing? Interestingly, the data that we are receiving is, one, we have changed the metrics of attrition, where we see our millennials and our Gen X, typical people getting into a job 3 months, 6 months, stepping soon, and you leave. But we have changed the attrition metrics with our graduation graduates, that they are able to stay longer. And they can actually hit the ground and run faster than their peers who started at the same time, because they have literally been prepared for the role. For our retail program, I want to put out one interesting statistic. Is a lot of supervisors are actually saying your graduates somehow are able to influence the others against the petty theft that you see in a supermarket or a retail outlet. Because one of the pain points the employers came on board when we were doing the retail curriculum is, we are struggling with youth that have integrity. So we have a great integrity at the core of our retail curriculum. And we have seen this translate to 70% of our employers actually saying, I can see the results of integrity being ingrained in our youth. Yeah.
Great, great. Mark, Joyce, Abugani, Sylvia, thank you very much on my behalf. Audience, please thank you so much.